The increasing presence of motorcycles on our roads and the high speeds at which they can travel has resulted in an increase in fatalities due to crashes. In 2015, there were 111 fatalities as a result of motorcycle crashes. Since the start of the year, 35 motorcyclists and pillion riders have lost their lives due to crashes. Over 90% of those killed were not wearing a helmet.
The law requires not just a driver of the motorcycle, but also the pillion passenger to have their helmet on.
Road traffic injuries are a major public health problem and a leading cause of death and injury. The loss as a result of motor vehicle crashes cost the country millions of dollars each year, but the loss is more than monetary.
We can't tabulate that, because what is the cost to a family of losing a brother? What is the cost to a family of losing a mother on the road? We can't tabulate. And I hate to hear when persons say road crashes cost X amount of billion, because it doesn't. It costs much more than that. How do you say to a two-year-old child who is getting to go and to take their exams to go to high school and daddy's not around or mommy's not around? What's the cost of that? Because when people die in a road accident, the cost to the loved ones that are left behind is immeasurable. A lot of persons die without a will, and that's another heartache in terms of sorting out the assets of the loved one. The cost of grieving, you can't put a dollar on it. So what I want to encourage my fellow citizens to do, don't get involved in a crash so that we don't have to even think of the immeasurable cost. Because the loss of a loved one will never go away. It will never, the funeral might be over, but the loss that the loved ones feel cannot be tabulated.
The Ministry of Transport and Works is working hard to reduce the number of road fatalities with their CASH program.
And CASH stands for C, meaning choices. 80% of the reasons for accidents, it depends on the choices we make. So C is for choices, make the right choice. A, do not drink alcohol and drive. Alcohol diminishes your reaction time and leads to accidents. S stands for slow down or use your seatbelt. And we are encouraging persons to slow down and to use their seatbelt and to stay in their lanes. And H, if you ride a motorbike or a motorcycle, use your helmet. Wear it at all times. We believe if we use CASH, we can save more of our citizens on our roads.
One organization that is also working very hard to reduce the number of motorcycle crashes on our roads is Back to Basic Mission. They are involved in a campaign to get riders to wear helmets.
Can you tell me three common mistakes motorcyclists make on the road?
Well, three common mistakes are, I would say, three common scenarios that you have. In here in Kingston, one of the most prevalent scenarios they have is what we refer to as a hook collision. The hook collision is typically where a motorcyclist is moving through traffic and a motorist, typically what happens is the motorist don't necessarily see them in a mirror and so on, and so they end up turning directly into the path of the motorcycle. This is not something that's unique to Jamaica. It happens anywhere where you have a lot of motorcycles or a lot of cycles, so even pedal cyclists it will happen to. And it's extremely dangerous, extremely fatal. I would say more than 50% of all the fatal crashes in Kingston here would be that kind of scenario. That's one. The second scenario, very common in Western parishes, right, where people are white-lining at high speeds, in especially Westmoreland, St. Elizabeth, and you have two motorcycles that end up head-on into each other. The third scenario, if you want to call it a major factor in accidents, motorcycle crashes, is simply what I want to call group pressure, peer pressure. Right, you will have a situation where a bunch of guys say, okay, we're going to ride somewhere. Typically in a weekend, typically at night time, they're going to ride. You'll have somebody who for some reason can't necessarily keep up with how with the other group of riders. Not at the same skill level, not focusing, etc. And you have a thing where that person ends up getting stretched beyond their capabilities as a rider, just trying to keep up with whatever is happening. Maybe they're heading to parties, they're doing all kind of different stuff. Right? So in Back to Basics, we look on a scenario like that now and talk about solutions, right? Understand that you need to understand what you need to each rider needs to understand what their own personal limit is. You know, you need to not yield to peer pressure. You have to basically be able to stay inside your own zone and know how to assess yourself so that if you're riding with five riders, it don't matter who your limits and how you stay safe is with respect to what you know you're capable of. And your mental state, your state of mind, whether things are bothering you, whether you've been riding often enough, all of those things you alone are in control of, right? The condition of your motorcycle. So all of those things. So that's the third thing.
Tariq, how important is wearing safety gear and how can it help?
All right, safety gear is critical, you know, but it's easy for me to just say safety gear is critical and people not get the point. You know, so I really have to articulate it a little more. In our workshops when we're on the road, we show a crash, a colleague of mine doing about 135 miles an hour, somewhere between 120, 135 miles an hour, and he crashes at that speed, right? And we show the entire class, I say, how many injuries do you think this guy had? And everybody start listing out a long list of stuff, said this must broke, that must broke, right? And when you sum it up, all the guy had was an injured shoulder from a previous injury. So he aggravated a previous injury because he was at the racetrack, he was at Dover and crashed with full safety gear on and was essentially able to walk away from it. He was supposedly unconscious for about, literally for around a minute or two, but beyond that, he's fine. And we have pointed out to people, say, if the technology exists in safety gear such that somebody can have a crash like that and be fine, why is it that we have so many fatalities on the road? You know, the primary reason why the fatalities are so high because people don't wear safety gear. It makes a difference. If you were to sit and talk to an emergency room doctor, they'll look on you and they tell you that it's well over 50% of all the motorcyclists who die in Jamaica, right? They would have had some chance or a better chance of survival. I would say, the doctor might say more than 50%, I would say as much as 80 to 90% of our fatalities could be averted, right, with simply wearing a helmet and wearing it properly. That's my personal experience when it comes to safety gear. Now, helmet being the most important one, you still want to have gloves, you still want to have jacket. Bottom line is that your skin was not made to fall in love with asphalt. Your skin was not made to fall in love with asphalt. So the minute you fall off a motorcycle, for whatever reason, whether it is your fault or somebody else, that as much safety gear as you can afford is important to have.
Tell me some of the safety gears one should consider wearing or should wear before going on a motorcycle. That includes the pillion.
All right, the first thing, helmet. I want to explain that statistically speaking, right, as many as 8 out of every 10 motorcyclists who have been involved in fatal crashes in Jamaica, 8 to 9, right, would have had a much, much better chance of surviving if they simply had on a helmet. Your head is not designed. Your head is not designed to hit the ground even at say 5 to 10 miles an hour. All it takes is the wrong curb for your head to hit the wrong curb. It doesn't even have to be a curb, it can be a windscreen and your life is over. Helmet is the most important thing. Now there are some other stuff. You're talking about wearing a jacket because your skin not designed to rub asphalt either. All right, gloves. As simple as you take it, yes, you might have your head if you're wearing a helmet and you might have on a jacket, but if you're riding without gloves and a simple fall and something on the ground cuts your hand and you end up having to lose your fingers. So order of priority is helmet first, right? Gloves, jacket, even though jacket is a difficult thing to wear sometimes in our summer heat. Next thing I want to point out to people is to wear your boots. As in, wear something, solid shoes that are going to protect your toes, you know, based on the kind of riding you're going to do. So if you know you're going to be riding at highway speeds, you need heavier shoes, right, and heavier gloves. You know, those are the basic things. You also need to be concerned about the kind of pants you have on. You should be in pants, not a skirt, as you know, right? You should be in pants. You want something, at bare minimum, jeans. But they can tell you that at highway speeds, jeans are not really enough. But under no circumstances should you be riding around in shorts, for example. It doesn't make sense. You have no protection against the basic things that can happen to you. Those are the basic safety gear that a rider should be looking at. Helmet, gloves, jacket, shoes, and a solid pair of pants that you're going to use that will actually give you some skin protection.
So what about pillion riders?
Pillion riders, I would say the same thing, but it's not realistic based on how the pillion scenario in Jamaica. pillion riders should be wearing a helmet. Now, I would dare say, to some people's opinion, it is even more critical with the pillion. I've been riding around bikes for 30 years, and I've had incidents, right? The thing is that when it comes to riding and knowing how to fall and knowing how to anticipate situations, pillions are usually very vulnerable, right? So you have many situations where if two people ride without a helmet, the rider is fine, but the pillion is not. You know, the pillion is not as prepared, generally speaking, for what will happen in terms of their knowing how to fall properly and all of that. So if push comes to shove, the pillion need the helmet, like, whoa.
Tell me about Back to Basics.
Well, Back to Basics mission, really, I love motorcycles for a very long time, for decades. I never even bought one because of those family issues. My family, like most families, you wouldn't want your son to have a motorcycle. And I have love and respect for them. At some point, I decided that I needed to get involved. And I took a certain approach of studying motorcycles, them as a machine, material, contacting people locally and internationally. And so I found myself knowledgeable. Now, Mr. Grinnell reached out to me, right, at one point, and said, look here, Tariq, we're doing the Road Safety Expo. This was around 2014, 2015, somewhere thereabouts. 2014 it was. And he said, you're doing the expo, they notice motorcycle fatalities are going up. Would you come and do a presentation? So me, I'd never taught anything before. I just gathered the knowledge that I was already gathering. I might just share with one and two friends, and decided to start making this presentation. And coming out of that one event, I had several people, including the road safety unit, including people from inner city communities who were at Grinnell's, who said to me, Tariq, your information is great. And I'm like, please, we need you to carry it into the streets. We need you to carry it to the communities where the riders are. So that with that initial reception, right, it kind of motivated me. Road safety unit reached out to me at one point because there was a crash among the staff of National Irrigation Commission. And they needed some safety training for those riders. There was a fatal crash. And we organized our first real all-day workshop for that government entity. And at that time, we're not doing anything as a business or any regular operations. This was our first time doing a proper workshop. And again, the response, the criticism that we got. I remember one old man who was riding for over 30 years, and he seemed miserable in the morning and in the evening. I wanted to hear his feedback, right? The big criticism we got when that old man stood up was, Tariq, why aren't you teaching all of this to the entire Jamaica? He says he's been riding for over 30 years, and in the 30 years of riding, he did not learn half of what we just taught him in a one-day course. And the other half that he already knew, he learned through pressing and rocking up. So it's like, if the course is this good, why aren't you teaching it? The person was running HR for National Irrigation Commission also echoed the same sentiments of the employees who had just received the training, which was that the quality of it was extremely high. She didn't even ride motorcycles, but she learned a lot, and she was strongly encouraging us to take it to a national level. So that's what we basically did. From that point, we basically started looking for funding partners, we basically begin to put the documentation to figure out how are we going to get it funded so we can go as often as far as we can on a national level. Noting in all of this that it didn't even start from any, it was not monetary interest. We just saw something that needed to be fixed and decided we're going to commit ourselves to doing it. From that small start, we've had good support both from Road Safety Council, National Road Safety Council, Insurance Association of Jamaica. Sandals has been our big sponsor in the West. We've seen group training. We've done training for Red Stripe for Celebration Brands, and they had injuries and serious injuries reduced by 50% or close to 50%. That's the kind of impact we saw. The minute we started doing national outreach, the first time we went to Westmoreland, for example. We went to Westmoreland, I think it was May of 2016. And I don't even fully understand the science, but for a total of around 2.5 months, there wasn't even a single fatality in the parish. So after we came with our flyers, we put them all over, we ran just one workshop. The level of discussion that it caused in the community made a difference. And that's been the pattern. Now, since 2018, it has gotten even better, because all of 2017 we were doing workshops all over the island, or mostly focused in the West, but we did quite a bit of education and PR, all kind of stuff, working with the Road Safety Council. And for the first 3 months of this year, the fatalities fell by, I believe, over 50% again. So there's a consistent pattern that when you're putting if you keep putting knowledge out there, if you let people realize that a motorcycle is a thing that you need to learn about, it makes a big difference. When I say learn about, I don't mean just learn about how the machine works. Learn about what are the safe ways to interact with traffic in this environment. You know, we have an environment in Jamaica where the regulators have not given much thought about how motorcycles and cars should interact on our roads. Right, we have a practice where most motorcyclists ride on the white line and in between lanes. Now when I say most, I mean police, government employees, all motorcyclists, statistically speaking, are close enough to say all do it, but there's no regulation of that. There's no agreement that this is safe to do, this is allowed, that's not allowed. So in a context like that, we have basically taken a lot of the time to document best practices, the best way for motorcyclists to deal with all of these different scenarios and put it into, we've been gradually putting it into documentation. So you could literally become a school. We could literally become a place, I call it a sort of university, a collection of knowledge where people can learn about operating a motorcycle safely in an environment like Jamaica.
Tyree, do you think our lawmakers should put in a legislation which forces motorcyclists to go to a school, right? Such as back to basics, to understand the basics of the road before they are actually given a license to go on the road?
Okay, now the first part of that is, under the new Road Traffic Act, there is that provision. Under the new Road Traffic Act, all drivers, all operators of motor vehicles will have to be properly certified and do some kind of training. Under the new act, that will mean, for example, driving schools. For you to operate a driving school, you're going to have to be certified to do that, right? Back to Basics mission, based on how we've been growing and developing, is well positioned for that with regards to motorcycle training, not just by having a curriculum that's well developed, right, and that is in line with best practices internationally, but also a curriculum that responds to things that are unique to Jamaica. So we that's the direction that they want to go in. But to speak about the Road Traffic Act a little more, there's one change to the act that motorcyclists need to be aware of. It's something that we strongly support and we have even been advocating for. They've inserted a lot of things to try and help to increase the amount of safety amongst motorcycles. A lot of little details, but there was one that we were pushing for in particular. That is the learner situation. Motorcyclists in Jamaica now are able to ride on just a learners, right? That could mean that the person has never been taught, never. It's not like in a car where you have to have a driver beside you at all times, right? They've never been guided at all, which is a very unsafe situation. Now, what we were advocating for and were successfully advocated for is that if you are learning to ride, then somebody should be teaching you. If it can be a properly qualified cousin, family member, but I personally, if it was my son, and my son says he wants to learn to ride a motorcycle, I may buy him a motorcycle, yes, but I'm going to go on the road with him. I may ride one, him ride one, carry him in a football field, make him do certain things, basics, and then, learn, go through a process of learning. So under the new Road Traffic Act, that is how it will be. You will no longer be able to just go on the road with just a learners, claiming to be learners, but you're going through New Kingston or you're going about your daily business with just a L on the bike. If you're learning, learn. Have somebody teach you. Just like with a car, somebody should teach you when you're driving a car. Same thing with a bike. If you're learning, right, you should have somebody teaching you. Now, what that will mean is not necessarily somebody sitting on the same bike with you, because if you can't ride, I'm not going on a bike with you. But that's not the way how motorcyclists are generally taught. How motorcyclists are taught is you have two motorcycles, right? Typically it's one that the motorcyclist can handle, as in nothing too big. And two motorcycles ride side by side, and a more experienced rider will look and say, all right, don't do this, don't do that. And if you're doing that with a certain curriculum in mind, that is the best way to be introduced to a motorcycle, or how to use or not use a motorcycle on the road. So the Road Traffic Act has laid the framework for that kind of environment and that kind of change. And I think that ultimately over the next 5 to 10 years, that's going to make a big difference. Because if you imagine if every single rider, every single new rider on the road now will know that look, if you're gonna ride a bike, somebody has to show you what you're doing. You can't just jump on and do as you feel like. That's gonna make, that in itself is going to lead not just to back to basics being a school, but more people becoming riding instructors, more people becoming coaches, more sharing of knowledge so people aren't always learning the hard way.
We are here speaking to Jordan from Back to Basics. Jordan, tell me how important it is to get proper motorcycle training.
It is very important to get properly trained by somebody who knows how to operate a motorcycle correctly. The thing is that we have a lot of bad habits here in Jamaica. People learn from somebody, a family friend, a friend, you know, and they get bad habits passed down through the lines. All right, so there are ways and techniques of how to ride, where to position your hands on the handlebars that people don't know. And it's very important to get these fundamental instructions down and understood why they're doing it, right? So, and the training, it goes a long way, you know? So when you finish training with an instructor, don't think of yourself as being a big rider, a top rider, an expert. Always consider yourself a professional. You always keep learning. You know, there's a saying, a wise man learns from other people's mistakes and a fool, not even from his own. So it's very important that you learn from other people's mistakes, and if you make any mistakes yourself, that you learn from them.
Tell me about your role in Back to Basics.
My role in Back to Basics, I'm the practical riding instructor. So I help people to understand the science of riding a motorcycle. You know, how to steer properly, turn a motorcycle using counter steering techniques. How to position their body. Riding, that is very important to stay relaxed on the motorcycle. You see a lot of people riding with their arms up in the air, very tense. That's not the proper way to ride a motorcycle, you know. So these are bad habits that have been passed down from people who are just training. Some people learn how to ride just on YouTube, you know, and it's very surprising, but you know, you can't get everything from YouTube, because you know, you want to have somebody where you can ask questions, you can see if I'm doing this right, or you know, kind of perfect their technique on the motorcycle.
The message I'd send to all motorcyclists, you know, as a statistic show, is that the motorcycle is a complex tool, right? We have a tendency to think about it as just a bicycle with an engine, and the fact that we take that approach, it shows in the numbers. Right, I would want all motorcyclists to begin to understand, begin to take it seriously as a machine that you need to learn about, you need to keep learning about. You know, you need to keep learning, and not all of the learning has to be in school, you know. But understand it's a machine that you have to respect and keep learning for that purpose, right? It will bite you. It's not the thing, the motorcycle is not a machine you want to keep learning by trial and error, right? So the more training, the more knowledge you can get about how to ride and how to be a better rider and to be a safer rider, right? That's what we should have in our culture. A culture where people look on motorcycles as this kind of tool where I need to keep learning about. Some people compare a motorcycle to a bicycle. I compare a motorcycle to an airplane, right? And best believe that if a pilot not doing certain amount of recurring riding, training, whatever it is, you understand? If a pilot is not using his aircraft frequently, license going lapse.
So what?
If a pilot is not using his skills frequently, that alone will make him his qualifications lapse. A pilot has to do certain kind of recurring training, because at the end of the day, it's the kind of machine where if you get something wrong, the costs are very high. That's how I like to look at a motorcycle. A motorcycle, if I imagine any machine that can take you up to a certain speed in 30 seconds, in 60 seconds, if you see what some of these motorcycles are capable of, even at a low cost, take it serious. Be professional. Right? Something I always say, a lesson we always leave with people. I don't want to be an expert. I'm not an expert. An expert is somebody who knows everything. And best believe the one thing the expert don't know can kill him. I'd rather be a professional, because when you're a professional about something, you keep learning. A doctor as a professional has to keep learning to maintain his status as a doctor. And the same thing for a nurse, the same thing for a lawyer, you have to keep learning. So if you consider yourself to be a professional, or you should strive to be a professional motorcyclist, that's somebody who keeps learning. That's the message I'd want to send to motorcyclists.
Jordan, what is your message to motorcyclists?
My message to the riders on the road and motorcyclists is get rid of the hype, right? Everybody likes motorcycles, and they want to be seen on it. So they say that they don't want to wear a helmet because the girls can't see them face and everything. That's absolutely foolishness. And it doesn't make sense that you don't wear your safety gear and end up dead. You have family members, you have loved ones, you have friends who care about you, right? And nobody wants to bury you. Nobody wants to bury you. So get rid of the hype. Obviously, obey the rules of the road. I see a lot of motorcyclists breaking red lights, stop lights, all of these things for no reason. You know, no reason at all. They're in a rush for no reason. Also want to say, you know, be aware, be alert, ride for others. We have a duty of care on the road, right? Motorcyclists get a bad rap, but without motorcyclists in Jamaica, our productivity or efficiency as a country would be very low, you know. And the motorcycle is a tool of social inclusion for people to get jobs, to support their families, to earn a living, you know. So my message again to the motorcyclists, get rid of the hype, you know, keep practicing, keep training.
Tyreek, what is helmet life?
All right, helmet life. All right, Jason, come. Well, before I tell you, I'll show you this helmet here, sir. Helmet life, this is a helmet signed by the Prime Minister of Jamaica and by Sir Richard Branson, that's the Virgin Airlines billionaire. Helmet life will be the biggest motorcycle helmet safety campaign in Jamaica's history. We basically want to transform this country. We want to show everybody, every nook and cranny of this country, right, what the value of a helmet is. We want to bring it to a level of cool, not just among motorcyclists, you know. Your mommy, your auntie, your granny, every single person. We want everybody on board. When it comes to helmet life, we want every single person to understand. Say, if I see my brother ride a bike without a helmet, I'm going to tell him, I don't appreciate it. Me no want to bury you. Mother, father, everybody in the community. It should be at a point where by the time a policeman take out a ticket book to say I'm going to write a ticket for no helmet, everybody in the community is supposed to clap the police and say, yeah, him to get that ticket there from a long time. We want community involvement. So that's what Helmet Life campaign is about. We have one helmet signed by, we have three helmets actually signed by the Prime Minister and by Sir Richard Branson. One of them we intend to carry to the Prime Minister's office, the office of the Prime Minister, and that is supposed to be Jamaica's helmet. That's the nation's helmet. So we're giving that to the country. Signify the campaign. You know, this is to be on road.
Injuries to the head and neck are the main cause of death and injury among users of motorcycles. The Helmet Use campaign is a strategic measure to reduce road fatalities. I am Marlon Samuels. I support Helmet Life. You should too. Keep going, keep going. Get on the gas. Good. Keep going, keep going. Where are you looking? Keep going. Where are you looking?